Hi everyone, here's Abukamis once again. As I was reading Augie March, I kept thinking back to a certain life philosophy that the narrator and protagonist develops halfway through the book, and that plays a pretty important part in the many reflections going on through the book. At this point in the narrative, Augie is scrambling together a living by stealing books from Chicago bookstores that Danny sells to students and researchers strapped for cash. I'm not sure how much of a profit he can make out of it because he ends up reading half of the books he steals. Treatises on philosophies, classical texts, novels, medicine textbooks, and so on and so forth. Whenever he encounters a book that he doesn't quite get, an author that just bests him, he doesn't sweat it too much because of his philosophy, which is that whatever pursuit you're following, whatever you're trying to achieve in life, this thing should come to you either easily or not at all. If you don't find what you're doing easy, if it's not immediately accessible to you, you shouldn't bother. Anyway, it's described in the novel as a very human, very natural, but very toxic trait. This idea that many of us do not settle for what we're good at, but strive instead toward a career or an objective that is actually beyond our reach and that we can't possibly achieve. And this idea of things should be easy or should be ignored is something that's deceivingly simple. It's something I had at the back of my head as I was reading the book. Keep it in mind as we discuss it. Saul Bellow is a weird author. He was a Nobel winner for literature. At one point, he was considered one of the major figures in American literature. In some textbooks from the 60s especially, he is sometimes described as the key, the greatest writer, living writer in the US at the time. And yet, he has fallen out of grace in the last few decades, and I would genuinely be interested in knowing how many people are still reading him and still studying him. This, by the way, is by no means an exceptional condition in literary history. I remember being at an American poetry class during my MA, where the professor was honestly astonished by how few of us had even heard of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, which at one point was regarded as the greatest poet of the American 19th century. Generally speaking, there is nothing as flimsy as a canon. It's difficult to say exactly why Saul Bellow fell off the critical radar and readers' radars, more broadly speaking. Some people point at certain unhappy declarations he made late in his life about the value of non-Western cultural traditions. Some claim other causes. I personally believe that it has to do with the specific type of novel he was writing in a specific literary historical context. At least based on my limited experience, this is my second Bellow novel after Mr. Sumner's Planet, so I'm in no way an expert. Augie March came out in 1953. At the time, high modernism was still the gold standard of high, serious literature. The great masterpieces of high modernism had already been published a couple of decades before, but many of them had been censored originally. Things at the time moved a little bit slowly. There had been a world war in the middle to slow things down further, and modernism was still regarded as the great literature of the time. The immediacy and spontaneity of the beats would revolutionize things soon, but in 1953, On the Road still only existed as that legendary scroll rather than in book form. In many ways, the 50s were the age of the great triumph, and some might say the decadence, of the novel in the traditional, classic 19th century model. Even high modernism might, even the works of writers such as Joyce or Virginia Woolf, might read as experimental and disruptive to us, but they were just the final stage in the evolution of the traditional psychological novel. Stream of consciousness, this way of presenting events and thoughts on the page in a very direct way, was just the latest way writers had developed. to basically transcribe the thought process and the psychological dynamics going on in people's minds on the page. It was the evolution of what Henry James or George Eliot were doing in the 19th century. Similarly, high modernism was steeped in the classical tradition of learning. It's not a coincidence that the greatest work of modernism, supposedly Ulysses, is named after the classical text par excellence. Novelists in the 1950s, people like Saul Bellow, were taking a leaf from the modernist book and continuing in the realist psychological tradition of writers such as Jane Austen, Charlotte Bronte, Tolstoy, Proust, and so on and so forth. Ralph Ellison, author of Invisible Man, writes in that tradition. Vladimir Nabokov writes in that tradition too, although I will claim that Nabokov was also somewhat secretly quite ahead of his time too. In the 1960s, this tradition will be abandoned or at least discontinued. Postmodernism in the 1960s will push it to the extreme. At the end of the day, the great postmodern texts read to us, or to me at least, as every bit as difficult as the great modernist texts, but it will also explode this tradition. Postmodernism brings together a lot of references and influences from the realm of popular culture, which had no place in the very serious, very classical tradition of modernism. Even in the mainstream realm, writers like Philip Roth or Raymond Carver, Updike too, write in a very different key from this 1950s novel, from the works of Bellow or Ellison, that represent this culmination of this classically steeped tradition. I remember once hearing the writer Abram Joshua, Israeli writer, claiming on a stage, very controversially, saying that if we were given the chance to pick between the novel, all novels as they were written before 1950 or as they were written after, none of us would choose the recent novels. All of us will go with the classical tradition, which I disagree with. I would totally choose the more recent decades. But I see what it means at the same time. It's difficult to point exactly at where the distinction lies, but pre-1950, and I would argue even more pre-1960 novels, read very different from contemporary works. This classical tradition could not really survive in the world of paperbacks and rock and roll and social upheaval that was created in the 1960s. As a consequence of this, of the fact that Augie March is a great work in a tradition that has today disappeared, and for good reasons too, I would add, for this reason, I think it's very difficult for us to appreciate what it is exactly that makes Augie March a great work, because there are many, many reasons why it was hailed for decades as a great American novel. Even just the fact that its protagonist, Augie March himself, this guy from a very poor background, grew up as an orphan in a house that wasn't even his, it belonged to his grandma, in a poor neighborhood of Chicago, among other immigrant families. The way this protagonist is described as a quintessentially American hero was quite revolutionary at the time. This idea that this Jewish kid from an immigrant background was quintessentially American was quite innovative and even controversial. Even more controversial is the way the book is narrated. The natural clumsiness, the effortless awkwardness of the phrasing comes from the fact that Augie March's English is influenced by the speech patterns of Yiddish and Jewish, by the languages that were spoken in the neighborhoods in which he grew up. In a way, what Bellow was doing with the Yiddish idiom in Augie March isn't that dissimilar from what Faulkner was doing with Southern idioms and speech patterns in his novels. But the price you pay for this, the price you pay for the clumsiness of these sentences, is that Augie March feels like a novel that is constantly slowed down by its own language and its own phrasing, and not in a very beautiful way, if I must say. Moby Dick is also a novel with a really exciting plot. Let's hunt for a friggin' sea monster that is constantly slowed down by its language and reflections, except that those read as beautiful and wonderful to me. You feel like stopping and rereading these passages to appreciate appreciate the nuances and the brilliancy of the language in a way that didn't really happen with Augie March. Even my favorite passages of in the whole book, I couldn't truly read them as beautiful, as baroque. They just felt a bit awkward. Sadly, what contributes to slowing down the book further is how constantly Augie March stops, and I'm talking not about the book, but about the guy himself, to try and extrapolate some philosophical point or some existential reflection or some greater law about human relationships from whatever happens to him. This is a novel, again, because it's written in that great tradition where the narrator feels at liberty to stop the action at any time, and boy does he take that liberty, to try and develop these greater reasonings and these maxims on life, which is fine in small quantities, but not in the amounts you get throughout Augie March, and also feels somewhat jarring, because on the one hand, this is supposed to be a kid from Chicago who grew up in a tough neighborhood, was conversant with the criminal underworld of the city, grew up in pool rooms, stealing stuff from convenience stores, etc., and yet at the same time is constantly name-dropping Greek classics or Saint Augustine or whatnot. Interestingly, the book itself makes a point of this discrepancy and describes it as a very American process. At one point, Augie March goes to City College and describes the students there as these weird creatures, as these kids from poor backgrounds, from immigrant families, from the working classes, trying to get a degree so that they can get maybe a government job and improve their condition ever so slightly. But the paradox here is that you have these boys and girls who can't even... But the paradox here is that you have these young women and men who can't really afford proper shoes, but still can crack whatever mathematical formula is offered to them. You have farmer boys who can converse in Greek with great scholars. There is this idea in Augie March, expressed through these City College passages, that if you're American, no matter what's your background, ethnically and economically and so on and so forth, you can still aim toward nobility, toward even just a nobility of mind. And what is that if not the core of the American dream? And I believe that that is a somewhat toxic dream in a way. It's very easy to sell people poor labor laws and the absence of a welfare state if you convince them that if only they worked harder, they can just achieve whatever they want. But the way Bellow envisions this ideal in Augie March and the way it is presented in the novel still turns it and still makes it a beautiful thing. The ideals behind this are noble. In fact, another one of these machines for equality in the book, other than college, is unions, where workers from all walks of life, from all ethnical backgrounds, come together to fight for a common ideal. It's also presented as a quintessentially American institution. All of this is very noble, but it doesn't change the fact that for every philosophical reflection and aside that I could appreciate, there were at least two or three that I didn't get or that didn't seem to make too much sense and that weighed heavily on the flow of the book. All of which points toward the final point I'm going to make, the most unforgivable one if you ask me, which is that the adventures of Augie March are not nearly adventurous enough. A lot of interesting things happen to Augie March in the course of the book. He hells down all sorts of jobs. At one point he's a dog cleaner for fancy families, at another point he's hired by a Chicago gangster to drive immigrants across the Canadian border, he's involved in a shipwreck at one point in the novel, he even goes to Mexico with the explicit purpose of hunting iguanas with a giant eagle that he has trained himself, well actually his girlfriend at the time trained the eagle and they're going to catch iguanas and somehow that's a living. Isn't that amazing? No, it never is. all of these points, all of these subplots are never truly developed. They are just abandoned at a certain point. The novel doesn't in any way strive toward any giving the reader any kind of satisfaction on the level of its events, on the level of how its characters react to these extraordinary circumstances they're dropped in. At one point, Augie helps a dear friend get an abortion, which is a dreadful, horrible business in 1930s Chicago. Will he go to jail? Will she survive? Even here, the novel doesn't really take off and doesn't really give you any kind of narrative satisfaction. His brother is clearly suicidal throughout the entire book, but that too feels like yet another subplot that has not really been developed very artistically. Speaking of these two characters I just mentioned, Mimi and Augie's brother Simon, Mimi is a hot-headed, somewhat impossible woman who has very strong ideas about family and society, but who's also truly compelling and easily my favorite character in the book. And Simon too is so ambitious, and yet he is filled with so much darkness. Bellow's secondary characters definitely make the book, and they are among the most humane and complex and tridimensional I've ever encountered. It's just much more of a pity that nothing truly interesting seems to happen to them. If only their every conversation wasn't interrupted by three pages of philosophical reflections that name-drop Seneca and medieval theology and whatnot. Augie March was by far the most difficult book I've read this year, much more than 2666, which I was fearing so much more. And the obvious reason, I believe, is that idea that it belongs to an outdated tradition, steeped in classicism and in a certain conception of what serious literature should be, that feels very outdated. To me, at least. Remember that point I mentioned at the beginning of the novel, that idea that if something's not easy, if it doesn't come easy to you, you should abandon it? I must confess that I had it at the back of my head as I was reading the book, especially its second half, which I believe is much more confusionary and pointless than the first half of the novel. As I was reading it, I actually thought that Augie March was right, that if something felt so difficult and slow, and if the philosophical and artistic points of the narrative were so clearly lost on me so often, then maybe it didn't really make sense to spend time on it. Which is something that it goes entirely against my ideas of literature. I've always thought that if anything, it's important to dedicate ourselves and commit ourselves to difficult narratives, if for no other reason, because some of the most enjoyable writers I know were writers that felt very difficult to me the first time I read it, and that I just had to work on in order to fully appreciate. One thing I should mention is that for all that at one point I literally threw this book at the floor, when I finally finished it and finally reached the closing paragraph, I didn't get that feeling of frustration I get when I finished a bad book, that feeling that I kind of wasted my time. Instead, I got the very opposite. I got that small thrill of finishing an interesting journey, of finishing a good book. So what am I to make of that, and what's the answer to that question? Obviously, as could be expected, I don't really know. I'm happy I read Augie March. I hated it most of the time. The final thing I'll say about that debate concerning easy or difficult literature is that I believe many, many people in literary academia today read and study and work on books not because they like them, but just because they're important. Meaning usually they're difficult. You would be surprised by the amount of people doing their PhD, people working in academia or who undoubtedly will be working on books, who don't really like the books they work on at all. In fact, who either implicitly or explicitly don't like book at all, at least they don't like fiction. Which is something that is entirely incomprehensible to me, because it seems to me that if you don't love the books that you study, then what's even the point of doing it? How can you possibly connect effectively with these works of art if you lack that basic element of enjoyment and appreciability that makes them worth your time and efforts. By all means, do write your PhD thesis on Joyce or Bolaño or Woolf or whoever. And I do personally believe that literary canons are important, that they serve a purpose and there's a reason they exist. But I do believe that it damages literary studies in the first place, and that we stand to gain nothing from studying and teaching novels we don't really enjoy just because they are important. But that's my take. What do you think about The Adventures of Augie March? I really want to hear from Saul Bellow's fans. Are they still out there? Do people still read and enjoy Bellow? Let me know. I definitely enjoyed Mr. Sumler's Planet much more than Augie March, maybe even just because it's significantly shorter, and so it feels much more bearable as a dense, a slow, sort of reading. Thank you as always for watching the video, and thank you to my patrons for supporting it. Their name should be flashing on the screen right now. If you like my reviews, if you like the YouTube channel, you're always welcome to support it on my Patreon page. There's links in the description box. I might expand the Patreon page in the next few months and do something interesting for my patrons, offer maybe some rewards, some possibilities. I'll be playing with that. And let me know once more what you think of Augie March, what you think of Bellow, and what I've discussed in the course of the video in the comment section below. Thank you as always for watching. Bye, people.